blessed. Certainly wonderful to be with you all as we celebrate this day. Again, our service is spread out before you. While as it leads us this day, we take a few seconds to raise our hands and swing a little wave at everybody else who's here today and welcome them to God's house. Pastor Mark's getting some good signals to certain people, so he's here. Yeah, exactly. So, anyway, it's good to be with you as we worship together this day. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 605, Father Welcomes, Lord's Blessings.
Enable us in true humility to receive the remission you promise to your judgment and children.
Amen.
Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. God the Father has taken your sins and laid them upon our humble Savior, Jesus Christ. Because of Christ's sacrifice, God does not count your sins against you. He has taken them away. He remembers them no more. He preserves and delivers you as his child forever. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
How great are your works, O Lord, your thoughts are very deep.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High.
To declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night.
To the music of the lute and the harp, to the melody of the lyre.
For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work. At the works of your hands, I sing for joy.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
How great are your works, O Lord. Your thoughts are very deep. Remain standing, if you will, as we continue with the hymn of praise. The law of God is good and wise. One God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we continue with the readings for the day. Our Old Testament reading comes to us today from the book in Ezekiel, the 33rd chapter. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle reading comes from Paul's letter to the church in Rome, the 13th chapter, where he writes, Let every person be subject to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For the same reason, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed. Honor to whom honor is owed. Owe no one anything except to love each other. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Now the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand in honor of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that time, the disciples came to Jesus, saying, Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and be drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world for temptations to sin. For it is necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom the temptation comes. And if your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet to be thrown into the eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into hell or fire. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. For the Son of Man came to save the lost. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go in search of the one that went astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 that never went astray. It was not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him meet you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. We sing the beautiful hymn of the day, Thy Strong Word.
Thank you.
Ezekiel. So you son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked one, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak, to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. So far, the words of our text for us this day. Please be seated. In the name of Jesus Christ, who has delivered our soul from sin, death, and the power of the devil, dear friends, in his name. Chores. We've heard the word before. It's defined as a routine task, a duty, something that we are to accomplish routinely, daily. As you think a little bit in your mind, you can probably look back even to maybe the youngest among us, to the chores that were given you. Maybe they were small chores like making sure the garbage is taken out, or making sure the table is set or cleaned off after dinner. Maybe a little harder chore was keeping your room clean. Some, it's harder than others to do these types of chores. We all have chores in some way, shape, or form. When I was growing up, I had certain chores given to me by my dad. All five of us kids had certain chores to do. Now, I was one who sometimes would take a moment or minute or 30 minutes to get ready to go out and do my chores. My mom was amazed at how long it would take for me to get my work boots on to get outside to get the chores done. I can't count how many times over the years I've heard these words. No matter how long it takes for you to get ready, no one else is doing your chores. They'll be waiting for you. Chores. As we look at the text for today, Ezekiel has a chore. And yet, this chore sometimes is difficult to accomplish. Even though in its truest sense, it's a good chore. So I started thinking about some of the good routine tasks that I was able to accomplish when I was growing up, because singing, playing music, playing sports was a routine task. Same definition as a chore. But I like to do that. So often when we think of chores, it's a negative, and this is such a chore, to say it in another way. And yet God calls us today to do some family chores. That is for us to be about his business in proclaiming his word. And I pray as we do that, it isn't a chore in the negative sense, but indeed something quite different. A task that God allows us to do that we can do with a smile on our face, knowing that at times what we say might not come across as such. So we dive into Ezekiel here, now chapter 33. Ezekiel is in a long line of people who are proclaiming warnings to the children of God. He's called to do the family chores. He is a prophet of exile in Babylon with Judah. Many before spoke words about what the people of God needed to do, or not continue to do. They became displaced, they were carried away, because they weren't listening. Time and time and time again, God had warned them to stop it, to turn around, to repent, to come back to the Lord their God. Samuel and Nathan and Elijah and Isaiah, they all proclaimed the same message. Shape up. Get back to God. And year after year, generation after generation, children of Israel didn't listen. So they became refugees. Unlike a hurricane that might displace people, or like a war where people, their cities are devastated and so they become refugees in another town, in another place, it's not because of oppression that they are pushed out. Because they're not listening and they're not following God's way. So Ezekiel has this chore to tell the people of God what they will be forfeiting by continuing in this way. Big tent, big umbrella, the blessings of God. More specifically, his peace, his security, the land of milk and honey, wealth, and most important, a close relationship with their God. At this point, Ezekiel's chores wasn't a glorious or glamorous thing, because he heard people speak against this, just as those previous. They didn't want to hear these words. They wanted to live and let live, to do what you want to do, and not stay near and dear to God. Because of that, finally, the exile was necessary. And yet, in the midst of all of that, God's promise, the gospel message continued to ring true. In the midst of decay over decades, God did not leave them. His promise and his hope and his salvation was there every step of the way. God has called us as a family of believers, and he's given us family chores. Routine tasks that he calls us to do for ourselves, to stay in the Word, to be in worship, to grow in love toward a neighbor, and also to speak his truth. We are baptized children of God. We have been given all things, even life everlasting. And so it's our duty, it's our chore, it's our task to follow the same things that those have gone before us were to follow. Have one God. Worship him only. Do not ignore his commands. Do not refuse to live as God's people, to stop following his way. These chores are difficult at times as we deal with the struggles of this sinful body that so often doesn't listen, so often goes against the course that God wants us to go. It's easy for us in this day and age to shoot something out quick because I don't have to see any faces to post something or to share something. And it's easy to stop and go, should I really say this? Actually, it's kind of hard sometimes for us to do that. We as the family of God need to hear these words once again. To know that our God has called us to something bigger and better. The word used in Ezekiel is watchman. Ezekiel was called to be a watchman, so to speak. To remain faithful and to proclaim God's message, even if it wasn't going to be returned with big, smiling faces. So it is for us today. We need to continue to proclaim that wonderful message which God has given to you and to me. Because that, my friends, is a glorious chore. That we have the gospel message living within us, saving us, protecting us, providing, and hopefully emboldening us to sing his praises and to live as he would want us to live. That's what God wants. For us to recognize our sin, to fall on bended knee before him, repenting of our sins, praying to God for forgiveness, knowing he promises to do just that. I know sometimes the things of God and living in that seem like a chore for always to the very end of the age. I pray in that light we live with lives of thanksgiving and peace and joy because of what our great God has given to us. And oh, what we have to look forward to. One day when we see him face to face, when his promise is fulfilled. That's another wonderful truth for us as the family of God. Yeah, it's hard in Matthew 18 to call out a brother or a sister when they've sinned against you. We don't like conflict, most of us, we don't. And yet God calls us to reconcile. That's part of our family chore, is to be about reconciliation. Not about continually tearing down, but building up. Not pressing others down and saying, who's the greatest? Oh, it's me, because I'm doing this, that, or the other. Seeing a lot of that as well, maybe not specifically. We have to be careful that we don't look inward in the midst of these family chores. But the opposite, quite the contrary. In love and building up others, so that they might be drawn closer to our Savior and not be pushed away. These are just some of the family chores that God gives to us. As I think about the joy that God gives to me in this place and in this stead, same thing with Pastor Mark, it brings us great joy. We can't wait to do it, to share these promises of God, the one who says, I'm going after that one. Yeah, I've got 99. That's plenty. That's pretty good. The world would say that's fabulous. But I love and care for that one. That one is so important for me that I'm willing to do whatever it takes. And we know what he did. Went to the cross, died for our sins, raised again so that we might have that resurrection as well. He was willing to go after us. We were conceived and born in sin. And yet Christ reached down into us and said, oh no, know what I've done for you. I'm not going to leave you alone just because I've got 99. I'm coming after you because you are the most important person, thing, individual. You're the most important right now. Good chore God has given to us. He allows us, he doesn't need us, but he allows us to be here, to be his vessel, to speak, to pray, to love. As the text states, to love one another. In Romans 13, owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Time's a difficult chore. And yet, as we leave today, I hope you think about that and think of it as a good family chore. For us to go forth and love one another. I think back to those chores I did when I was a kid. Many times I didn't want to do them. But that was a part of what we were supposed to do. As God's children gifted today with life everlasting, may we look at his word and marvel. And follow his lead as he leads us in mind, in spirit, in body, in word, as we listen, and as we speak, and as we live. May we do these things with gladness. In Jesus' name, amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus for life everlasting. I invite you to stand with me as we continue by professing the Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed today. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. For all the children of God, the Holy Christian Church, that we proclaim the salvation of Christ wherever we are and to whomever we meet, let us pray to the Lord.
Father, we can share this.
For the living out of our vocations, that no matter our station in life or the calling we have been given, that we faithfully represent our Savior with lives of humility and faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Father, we depend on you as we serve you with our lives.
For all children, that they grow daily in the wisdom of the Lord, and for all parents and those who work to care for children, that they be guided in their important service of love, let us pray to the Lord.
Father, we depend on you as we live as your children.
For all who suffer in heart, mind, and body. Especially today, we remember in our family of faith Carl, Catherine, Ruth, Elena, and Bob, and those we bring before you in our hearts at this time. We pray, O Lord, that they with patience and faith receive the healing care that you offer. Let us pray to the Lord.
Father, we depend on you for your healing touch.
For these concerns and for every unspoken prayer that is on our hearts and our minds, that our gracious God would hear and answer us, let us pray to the Lord.
Father, we depend on you for everything. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Continue our worship and service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and to be our Savior. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we ask you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and lead us by your Holy Spirit. Give us humility and faith to receive the remission of our sins freely offered to us in his body and blood. With dependence upon you and gratitude in our hearts, we praise you, O Father, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on that night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, take and eat. This is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. We pray together the prayer our Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Please be seated. body and blood of your Lord and your Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and preserve you in the true faith and the life everlasting. Amen. Please stand as we continue with the post communion prayer. Well, God the Father, we thank you for the forgiveness and the renewal of life you have given us in the precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Because we depend on you for everything, grant us your Holy Spirit, that we be sent forth to declare the wonders of our Savior to the world, he died to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord.
Sing praises to your name, O Most High.
To declare your steadfast love in the morning,
your faithfulness by night.
The Most High God now sends us out to praise his name and declare his love wherever we go. Receive the blessing of your Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please be seated as we sing our closing hymn.
Also, we have an outside work day coming up on the 19th,
I'm going to hold off of that because Ray asked to say a couple words about the insert that you have within your bulletin. He's got to change his shoes for his walking shoes from his organ shoes.
Good morning. It's raining outside, it's sunny in here. Good morning. How's everyone? Good. Just wish it was. I just wanted to take just a couple moments of your time just to make you aware of just a couple of things. Things may be slowing down out of the neighborhood, but things here, especially in Louisiana, Olive, doesn't slow down a bit. And so, our music ensembles, with the exception of choir, vocal ensemble, unfortunately, we can't start to meet yet, just because we're still under some restrictions from our health officials. However, all other ensembles, Olive Branch has already been meeting, and we will start to meet with brass and bells. If you are interested in participating in brass or bells or contemporary, we'd love to have you. We begin our rehearsals not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, which is Wednesday the 16th, with bells meeting at 6 p.m. and brass meeting at 7 p.m. This Wednesday, however, upcoming, is the 9th. And if you are interested in participating in bells or brass for Rally Day, which is a week from today, please do join us either at 6 or 7 p.m. this Wednesday. If anyone is interested, I'll be over at the Oregon after service to talk to you about that. If you took a look inside your bulletin today, you'll find something a little special. Our big announcement for Music at Mount Olive is we are kicking off our first annual, what I hope will be many, many years of an annual concert series. This year we'll be featuring bells, brass, Christmas lessons and carols, memorial music Sunday for Holy Week, and a vocal recital, an organ recital. Olive Branch will be doing something, and it'll take us from October all the way through till May. So there's something for everyone this year, and I really, really do hope that you'll, if not participate, then come and support. It is open to the public for the good old price of $3.99. And I like that. Please do come enjoy. Take a Sunday afternoon. All concerts begin at 3 p.m. on Sundays. Like I said, there's something for everyone. Enjoy. Please do keep up to date also for the Music at Mount Olive, website, YouTube channel, Instagram, Facebook. There's something happening here musically at Mount Olive for everyone. We're very, very happy. We're really, really excited to kick off everything beginning next week. So there it is. I hope to see you all. Blessings to everyone. Enjoy the week.
Thanks. Do you have announcements? Anything else to highlight? Wonderful picture on the front of our bulletin for today. We remember our kids and our families and our teachers and all those that have gotten back to school. Almost everybody's back. Some are just getting started still. Our preschool starts this week, and some of the universities haven't started yet. And so we continue to pray for our families and all those connected to schools or related to kids and families that are in school. It's a lot of us, and not all of us in some way, shape, or form. And so we keep them. And of course, what a wonderful text for us from Matthew 18. We wouldn't want any of them to perish, but to know the joy that is Jesus. And so we pray, of course, for our preschool starting this week, that, of course, is the central message. And we pray for you as parents, as grandparents, as people who are connected to our families, continue to filter the wonderful love of Jesus in the midst of all the things going on so that they might know all the more who he is. God's blessings as we share his word and as we do these wonderful chores which God has given to us.